So the next series of slides essentially shows, well, I'll go to a specific question from the survey and the response for three groups. The green are the top 10 WFOs in tornado, or in CSI for tornado warnings. The red are the bottom 10. The question is here, and then the categories of questions, or the questions were grouped by categories. So this first one says, how would you rate the overall job done by your immediate supervisor? And you can see that the top 10 performing offices, they felt better than the national average is the cyan color, and then the bottom 10, it was lower. Another question, my immediate supervisor is a technically competent professional, knows the job. So 91% of the responses in the top 10 performing offices felt that their supervisor, yeah.
Quick question. I'm wondering if were they aware of their performance when they were asked these questions?
We don't know.
Okay. I'm just wondering if they're independent or not.
Another question, my immediate supervisor is competent in human relations, dealing with people who work for him. So you see, in this case, not much difference between the national average and the bottom 10. The top 10 stand out. I can depend on my immediate supervisor to support me in the face of opposition, the same sort of trend. Fairness question, is there trust between employees and my immediate supervisor? Same sort of thing. There seems to be a bigger feeling of trust at the better performing offices. How would you rate the extent to which management treats you with respect and dignity? Same sort of thing. Communication. Obviously, in a chaotic warning decision environment, communication is very important. If you're not communicating well amongst yourselves, then that could result in poor decision making. Management promotes effective communication among different work groups. Here again, the bottom 10 and the national average were about the same, but the top 10 performers were above that. In my NOAA line office, management is receptive to change that will improve the working environment. That starts to get into some culture. Leadership, how would you rate the extent that management takes action on employee ideas and opinions? Very low across the board, 47%. It was at the top 10, but it's, again, the same trend. So starting to see a fairly interesting signal here. Supervisors in the weather service take time needed to properly manage their employees. Same thing. The weather service is one team working together to fulfill the weather service mission. This one's an interesting one because, you know, how does the local office sort of grapple with that question? They're sitting and, you know, in different parts of the country with not a real handle on, they don't visit every single office, so how do they know that? But you still see that the top offices feel better about that. The Weather Service has a family-friendly work environment. So here, there wasn't much difference between the top 10 and national average, but the bottom 10 ranked that much lower. So, so I was, frankly, when I went in this, I thought that there really wasn't going to be any signal. My thought going in was that when the tornadoes are hitting the fan, that whatever's going on in the office sort of takes us back seat, and then they rise to the occasion, and every office is, you know, will perform as needed. So this signal was very surprising to me, anyway. So the first thing I did was said, well, since a lot of these things seem to deal with supervision, that I should talk to the MICs at the top offices and just sort of get a handle on, you know, what are they doing? So I did phone interviews, and these are sort of a distillation of the results from these interviews, commonalities, if you will. Manager leadership is demonstrated through action, working shifts, severe weather, often in a subordinate role. So this seems to resonate a lot in weather service, the idea that the guy who's in charge is capable of, you know, just being one of the guys, so to speak, and getting in there and assisting and not micromanaging, which is the other one. They don't micromanage severe weather operations. I asked all the managers, you know, did they have some role model that taught them to be good supervisors? And a lot of them said they had had the opposite, an anti-role model, that there was some SOB that they worked for back in this office or that office, and they vowed that if they ever became an MIC, they would not be that way. Managers back up their forecasters' decisions. Managers foster open dialogue. Managers are careful in hiring people to enhance the existing team. And there's an office commitment to improvement. So that was another thing. And Gary Fine, which I'll get to in a minute, you know, he picked up on this too, that some offices, there's a bigger emphasis on improvement and performance.
Steve, yeah? Was training a part of office commitment to improvement, or did you ask?
I think that came up. I didn't ask specifically. I think it came up, and I think that was definitely part of the case. Following up on this, managers work closely with the union representatives. Managers support family personal needs. Offices seem to have low staff turnover. Managers have a strong focus on making the work satisfying and enjoyable. That was not, you know, that one was good to hear, but it's not necessarily the case in all offices. Managers work to make sure that all employees are appreciated, both their METs and their non-METs. Managers reward quickly and often. Management support. The management team, the WCM and the MIC and the SU are all sort of on the same page, so there wasn't infighting in the management group. So obviously this little look in here was interesting, so we decided to do a rigorous statistical analysis to see if the signal we were seeing was actually real or not. So we looked at essentially a subsample of all the offices, 50. So offices west of the Rockies were excluded, as well as those reporting fewer than 5 tornado events in 2001, 2002, and those with fewer than 5 employees completing the survey. So that got us down to 50 offices, you know, essentially west of the Rockies. Not all of them. And just, you know, for a moment, the culture of the, of, you know, what commonalities of the WFO is that it's sort of like a family unit. There's 20 to 30 people, and they're isolated from other offices. Sometimes people, you know, like bounce around their career to end up at the office where they want to be. It's really relatively homogeneous in gender, ethnicity, age. There's a lot of experience, 10 to 50, 25 years of experience. Typically, it's unionized, which can be contentious. And core values, there's a high value placed on science and technology, obviously, and dedication to mission. So you see that over and over again in weather service from headquarters on down. You know, people really love their jobs because of the dedication to mission and the science and technology aspects. So just focusing on a moment on a tornado warning decision. When I have given this talk to non-meteorologists, you know, I want to make the point that the tornado warning decision is a subjective decision. It's made by humans. There are lots of factors that are considered, you know, like the radar identifying a strong storm. Are there signs of rotation? Are there spotter reports? Have other storms in the area produced tornadoes? Where is the storm heading? Will it remain tornadic? But it's a very freighted decision. There's, you know, the missed event is a huge problem. You know, so the guy or gal making that decision has these things on their mind or somewhere in there, maybe in their subconscious. They may have family, friends, or relatives who are in the path of a tornado, you know, or a storm that's likely to become tornadic. So the decision is really, really is an important one that has a lot behind it. It's not a cavalier, oh yeah, tornado, boom, we just let it go out.